Welcome to Tell Me Your Story, New Paradigms for a New World. It's our 12 of 12 parts of Mythosophia, exploring the depths of myth and wisdom. And I have to tell you, my co-host, Will Lynn, this is the first program I have ever done where I actually have, I kid you not, goosebumps. There's something, I don't know what's going to happen in this program today, but I'm very excited about it. And it's good to have you back on the program for the 12th time this year.
Great to be back.
Incredible series that we've had this year. Incredible topics on mythology from sports and science fiction, comics, video gaming.
We stretched it.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah. Just incredible stuff. And you surprised me on a couple of the programs in that regard as well. So it's been, without a doubt, great fun. And today is going to be no exception.
So today we're going to be interviewing and talking with Patrick J. Mahaffey, Ph.D., who is a core professor and the associate chair of the Mythological Studies Program at the Pacifica Graduate Institute, which he chaired for 18 years. His teaching and research focus on Hindu and Buddhist traditions, comparative philosophy of religion, God complex, and contemplative practices. He has practiced Hindu forms of meditation for 40 years, has participated in retreats at ashrams in India and Australia, and has lectured at the Parliament of World Religions in Melbourne. His publications include essays on Hindu yoga traditions, Buddhism, and religious pluralism, and he is the editor of Evolving God Images, essays on religion, individuation, and postmodern spirituality. His perspective is that of a scholar practitioner who has engaged in Hindu forms of yogic sadhana for nearly 40 years. So welcome, Patrick.
Thank you, Will. I'm delighted to be here.
You don't get out much, do you, Patrick?
Thank you. I'm busy.
It's great to have you with us.
Thank you so much. I think Mythosophia is a wonderful forum for discussing leading-edge ideas regarding systems of meaning and value in a pluralistic world. And I think it has great usefulness to your listeners to clarify and expand their own worldview. And I think even more importantly, that the discussions help us understand others different than ourselves from other cultures and other religions.
Thank you, Patrick. And I got to step back and talk. Before we talk about the content of this book, I want to talk about the project. This was a project you did. You chaired the program for almost 20 years. And then in your first year as stepping down and away from those responsibilities, you took on an additional class, a God complex class. And so this, you wrote a book or you edited a book with your students of that very first class that you taught. And, well, there are many, many things I want to say, but the main thing is that the book is a collection of postmodern voices, a collection of voices on spirituality and their very, very, very personal spiritual experiences. And I've read many of my friends' essays in this book, which has been really delightful. Dan Gurska and Dan Ortiz, a number of wonderful essays. And I just want to say that this book, and we're going to talk about the intro, but the essays in this book represent such a robust, rich, and encouraging survey and set of examples of spirituality in today's world. So thanks for offering this book for everybody.
Thanks. It was really a delight and really a surprise. It was kind of a Zen mind, beginner's mind experience. Because Pacifica's academic programs, the myth program in particular, is a very academic program, but depth psychology is the substrate of it all, which requires and invites some self-reflection. And the final class presentations were surpassed my expectations so much that the next day I just found myself thinking these essays ought to be compiled and organized in some meaningful way, and that's what I did. There's 24 of them, and they fall into different categories, some of which include, you know, more traditional theistic belief, others who are more interested in goddess spirituality and the divine feminine, a third category that reflects people who have turned east, persons like myself, actually. Lastly, I think an emerging area of a secular and atheist aesthetic versions of spirituality. And it's my clear sense that that's a leading edge in our culture, and I think we're going to see a great deal more of that. And these doctoral students were, I think, forerunners in that regard.
Okay, so we better get right straight to the material because we're doing it. So I have apologized. This is a longer question. I want to frame a little bit of our conversation with it. So bear with me. It's a little bit of a setting up some of the history that's gone into our current situation. So Descartes set a precedent for Western philosophy when he articulated the notion that to consider a belief knowledge, it has to be built on solid foundations that you're certain about. But from this point of view came two of his really strong influences on Western philosophy, Cartesian foundationalism and radical doubt. So He ultimately argued that the only way to overcome reasonable doubt is to construct a belief system on a very solid foundation. And Albert Camus continued this line of reasoning. He offered the image of a mountain peak as a visual for ultimate truth. So where Descartes believed he had found an ultimate foundation in the existence of God, Camus did not believe he could find such an ultimate foundation. He communicated this through an allusion to the myth of Sisyphus, in which the damned character was unable to settle his stone atop the mountain. From this perspective of Camus' allegory, the stone cannot be settled atop the mountain because a stable and ultimate truth cannot be established or maybe does not even exist. So my first set of questions are these. Is Camus right that there is no foundation in our today's world for us to rely on? Is Descartes right that we can't be sure of anything without such a foundation? And what are some of the reasons contemporary individuals find it so difficult to establish some foundations on which they can build their beliefs?
Great questions, and let me take them up one at a time.
Totally.
So first of all, is Camus right? My short answer is yes and no. I think there is no foundation that can give us absolute certainty, and that's the key word there, the one I emphasized, absolute. And more importantly, I think we have to realize and actually embrace the fact that it is naive and even dangerous to assume or seek a foundation that could be valid for all individuals and cultures. Diversity of belief systems is a fact, a reality that actually has been true for millennia. Mm-hmm. What's different now in our contemporary world is that we are increasingly aware of different belief systems and ways of life. And not only that, it is imperative that we navigate and negotiate those differences, which we encounter in our day-to-day life. I believe it's entirely possible and necessary for one to be securely established in a viable system of meaning mm-hmm. without insisting that it be absolute. Mm-hmm. And I can elaborate on that conviction more as we continue. But on the second question, about whether if we can't be sure of a foundation, what basis can we have,
right.
For beliefs? First, I'd want to say that I don't think a lack of a certain foundation in any way plunges us into what might be called debilitating or destabilizing skepticism, or worse yet, nihilism. Hmm. However, we do need to understand that doubt, ambiguity, and uncertainty are natural for human beings, and especially in a world that is increasingly complex. So our task is to be secure in our beliefs and values while coping with those kinds of feelings. Mm-hmm. And that, is a developmental task, both for individuals and for cultures. It's an issue of maturation. And let's just take the word faith, and I'll put some quotation marks around it, because it plays a key role in virtually all of the world's religious traditions, but it's a loaded word for many of us, particularly in secular cultures. And I certainly don't mean blind faith or absolute faith. Instead, faith means something more like trust, and ultimately, trust in your own ability to make decisions and to cope with feelings and to live your life as best you can. So it means the willingness to base those convictions and values on a commitment to being a better human being. Mm-hmm. Now, what is a better human being? A person who has a capacity to love, to care for others, to push beyond self-centered needs, to be more understanding and tolerant of other people, to be compassionate regarding the needs and the sufferings of people other than oneself and others that you're close to. I think one of the reasons that some people find it difficult to find a belief system is not really so much to do with a lack of an absolute or certain foundation, but rather with materialism and consumerism. Mm-hmm. And I want to use that term materialism in two ways. First, a craving for material goods, often to the point of addiction.
A consumeristic.
Exactly. But secondly, a worldview that values what is visible and measurable. So a materialistic worldview in this double sense is a world that lacks depth, a way of being in the world that is cut off from dimensions of our being that emanate from our interiority. Hmm. So that would be my initial reply to those first questions.
If we reduce everything to matter and we see matter as like dead and inert and ultimately purposeless, then our foundations of using matter as a foundation doesn't get us very far as spiritual individuals.
That's right. And we may be getting ahead of ourselves here, but I think what I'd want to add in this context would be that the notion that matter is inert and mm-hmm. lifeless mm-hmm. is a very recent,
right.
you know, bias in Western culture, flies completely in the face of most of the wisdom traditions or religious traditions, and certainly indigenous cultures. And I think a leading edge for us now is to actually to discover that matter is, in fact, inherently alive.
I'm with you there.
With sentience. And that matter and nature is part of a vast self-organizing process mm-hmm. of emergent creativity.
Well, let me ask you, mm-hmm. in regards to a specific example, which unfortunately we don't repeat often enough in our own individual lives, 8.5 years ago, I lost my job due to the sale and the lack of ownership wanting to keep the old staff on, and my wife quit her job. So we were sitting around watching television, 1st of March, 2006, and the question came up, what do we do? You know,
yeah.
And of course, we could have gone out probably and found jobs in Phoenix, but my wife said, I feel like we're on the edge of a precipice. Now, I've been doing this for 35, 40 years. Mm-hmm. I've been on my search, as you have shared. Mm-hmm. I went to the East as well. I was born and raised Catholic, Western Rite, and found Autobiography of a Yogi at 17, and have been rereading that over and over again and being connected with different mm-hmm. people in that regard mm-hmm. for the last few decades. But that experience and that specific experience, I said to her, I said, well, of everything I've experienced, of all the people I've interviewed and all the books I've read and all the personal growth programs I've went through, they always say mm-hmm. the same thing. When you find yourself at the edge of a cliff, you do two things. You jump. And this goes to what you said, you trust.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Now, the funny thing about all of that was, most of my life I have been worried about money and making sure that it's coming in and making sure all the bills are paid. There was no fear whatsoever in that time period or that statement to her. Our house went on the market, we moved in May, et cetera, and the rest is history, as it were, and here we are today. Where, first of all, where does that fall in what you've just described? And have you found a way through your search and searchings and investigation to tap into that intuition, which is another part that what you guys were starting to, you're starting to get into, we're starting mm-hmm. to get into, about spirituality.
And the very personal experience of
yeah.
versus necessarily going, Pastor, I've lost my job, what do I do? You had a very personal
yeah.
relationship.
I didn't go to someone else. It was, I've had these,
it just felt,
this other input that is kind of guiding me, the mentors of my life, whether they be official or unofficial. So tell me, where does that experience fall in your explanation, and how do we get into the habit of falling back into that jumping and trusting experience?
Well, first, I think your personal experience exemplifies exactly what I was trying to explain. So you did jump, you did trust. That was a form of personal faith and an act of courage. And somewhat surprisingly, it seems, you know, you found that you lacked fear. You know, that must have been a real relief and a surprise. Now, why, and I can only speculate, you know, did you not feel fear in such a, you know, moment of transition like that? Well, I think structures that had served well and were satisfying, that you probably well could have, you and your wife could have gone on with, had come to a sort of natural end.
Mm-hmm.
And you had to let those dissolve before something new could emerge. Now, I'm going to mention an idea that is central to the Hindu worldview, but by no means unique to it. So there's three modalities that are fluctuating at all points in time, any moment in time. Things are coming into being, they're being created,
mm-hmm.
they're being sustained or preserved or maintained for a while, and they're being destroyed or dissolved. And as individuals and as cultures, as civilizations, economies, all phenomena really are subject to that kind of dynamic. And when those moments come, when things dissolve and unravel, I think that's the clearing or the space out of which new life and new forms emerge. But it does require the capacity to tolerate that unsettled, uncertain condition. And it sounds like you and your wife did that rather well. And how can one do that? Well, you know, each individual has to work that out. But I think to the degree that you can connect with a deeper part of your being that has nothing to do with your gender and your age and what profession you were in, and at least feel some connection to that, you begin to enter the realm of interiority that I was referring to, that can't be measured, that can't be directly pointed to, but is nevertheless fundamental to who we are and fundamental to reality itself.
What's interesting as you describe this is the trust was the way I phrased it, and even to this day, it's, well, I'm trusting the universe.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Well, what does that mean? Mm-hmm. You know, it's a phrase, obviously, that I've picked up over the course of time that sort of serves me, doesn't serve me kind of thing. You know, it's right. It's almost a New Age or metaphysical platitude. Trust the universe.
Right.
You know? And there was one other experience that I had when we took a trip to Ireland. And we went to one of the islands off of Galway. And there was this giant fort with a giant granite slab that stuck out over the cliff. And I chose to sit out on the edge of that.
But aren't you afraid of that stuff?
That was the amazing thing. I climbed out and sat on the edge taking pictures, and there was no fear. None at all. My wife kept asking me from a good 30 or 40 feet away, where's the life insurance policy?
Right.
It wasn't until we got back to the tourist stand, if you will, or shop, where on the back wall was a giant two-story mural of the very cliff from a helicopter shot. And it wasn't until 8 hours later, I'm lying snug and safe in the stone cottage in my bed. I am warm, and the fear hit me like a ton of bricks.
And you weren't even there anymore.
I wasn't there anymore.
So let's talk about the cliff we're on, because it's obvious our tendency, what we're going to want to do is immediately start talking about solutions. But I want to stick with some of the problems, because I think a lot of people in our culture, civilizations, are seeking paths and ways to have deeper relationships with the divine, or even if they don't want to call it that. But there are a lot of challenges, and I want to keep pounding out some of these challenges first. And one of them is plurality. Mm-hmm. So on one hand, plurality is very exciting, right? It's we're hearing from all these voices. We're hearing from you don't just have religion now. You have religion and science and multiple interpretations of all of them, and not just Christianity, but also multiple religions. And now also since World War II and postmodern movements, we've seen more and more, less just white men talking, you know? And so the plurality is happening. It's here. There is a lot of plurality, and I think we're almost inundated by it. And so on one hand, the postmodern child that I was brought up to be thinks this is wonderful. Let's support everybody, you know, being everybody. Everybody should get to be themselves. On the other hand, the question, you know, there is a bit of a inundation and a disorientation, I sometimes feel. And I was wondering if you could speak maybe to plurality, not just as a great thing, but is also it's some of its baggage and crisis.
Well, sure. When this a simple worldview can be comforting until you get tired of it and the acids of life around you begin to wear it down, at which point you have an opportunity to cling to what's familiar. And it's fair enough and reasonable enough, you know, for one to do that. But you might be having to hold in abeyance a lot of insecurity below the threshold of awareness about trying to cling in that way. Mm-hmm. So if you, and here I'm going to borrow a phrase well known in our culture, but used by no less a person than the Dalai Lama, who in his recent book called Towards a Kinship of Faves, talks about how as he grew up in Tibet, he thought that his Buddhism was by far the best religion, yet he quickly acknowledged he knew very little about any of the others. Mm-hmm. So he had an opportunity to travel to India for the first time, spend 3 months there.
Call it an opportunity, right?
Well, no, this was prior to the actual exile.
Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, but the experience I'm about to describe deepened after he had to permanently move to Dharamsala in India. And he encountered Hindus and Sikhs, and Muslims and others and theosophists, and he was astonished by the sincerity and the depth and the quality of lives that he saw people living. Mm-hmm. It just, he said when he returned 3 months later, he was a changed man and that he had moved out of his comfort zone. So the point, you know, that I'm borrowing here, you know, with that phrase is that if you move out of the comfort zone, you can be kind of destabilized by this inundation of,
right.
of options. But once you become acquainted with the variety of ways in which, you know, people can live and symbols that can animate your life, you have a rich new opportunities that may be far more refreshing and animating, you know, than what you were familiar with. So I think there's maybe a passage point, you know, that's uncomfortable, but it actually becomes far more freeing and liberating.
Interesting. Yeah.
As you move into that territory and find out about these traditions, and better yet, meet people.
Yeah.
Real people who are living these lifestyles and holding these beliefs.
Could you say? Sorry. Go ahead. Well, could you say a little more about what happens when people don't take that step, when people do cling and do kind of, in the face of plurality, almost put on headphones so they don't have to, or something?
Well, I'll be brief, you know, but my sense of it is that people feel increasingly isolated, increasingly separated, and afraid, and that this engenders, you know, conflict, you know, at the level of tensions, you know, in terms of living with near people that are different from you, and far worse, you know, international conflicts and wars.
Right.
And from my personal experience, going back into my 15-year stint at a Christian radio station, I found it fascinating that, number one, as I began to hear, read, and listen to all of the doctrine and dogma of that, and I have to maybe change the word from religion to philosophy, because it seems to me like, regardless of what label you take on, Hindu, Muslim, Christian, Buddhist, whatever, it's a philosophy. It's a way, because I keep hearing that. That's what I kept hearing from the Christians.
Yes.
This is a lifestyle. This is a way of life. Well, then it's a philosophy. But what I began to discover as I read my own personal reading and my own personal searching back and forth from the Holy Writ to, say, a concordance, was that it was all, not parts here and there, but all an internal experience. There was no external experience unless you had the internal experience. But it was still all a philosophical position that you took based upon, quite honestly, something that you don't know really exists.
Right.
You don't know God exists. You say he exists, but you don't know. You have the gut feeling. It's like that thing about jumping and trusting that I shared earlier. I just had no fear. I just knew that, hey, the universe would provide, that would take care of us as long as we kept moving. It's like we keep moving the footsteps forward and we'll be guided where we need to go. You have no proof that there's a heaven or hell. You have no proof that there are angels or, for that matter, that there's even an afterlife.
So it almost merges between a philosophy and a belief system.
Yeah,
right.
Exactly.
Or a worldview, which
or
is
a
the
worldview,
word I like to
and,
use.
And, because it, and then it becomes a worldview, as with, what was it in the, and forgive me for misquoting this, but was it the 15th century or the 16th with the Inquisition by the Catholics?
Lots of them. There are several centuries of Inquisition.
Yeah. And then, of course, then we have, and in a manner of speaking, I no disrespect to anyone, but in a manner of speaking, we're going through another form of Inquisition through sects of the Islamic world, sects thereof,
sects
not
of
the
all
whole
of them,
world.
Right?
Well, and in a way, from all of them, although I don't see Buddhists going out and actively trying to say, look, ours is the only way. And that was the one thing that always struck me. And
but I think that's so interesting that the Dalai Lama actually had this experience that we all kind of have where we feel like we should trust our own tradition more and we don't even and you know, we think that's normal and human, but I would have never projected that at the Dalai Lama.
But the other aspect of it is, as you said, Patrick, that he also said, but I have to admit, I don't know about the others. When someone comes to me and says, America is the greatest country on earth, my first question to them is, have you lived anywhere else?
Or
well,
even traveled anywhere else.
Have you traveled anywhere else? Mm-hmm. Oh, well, no, of course not. Well, then how do you know that? You believe that.
That's right.
But unless you've been somewhere else, and I've spent the equivalent of a month in Ireland, I would move there.
So here's what Descartes did. Descartes distinguished between beliefs and knowledge.
Yeah.
And he set an absolute standard for know when what you think is just a belief. know when it's just a belief. Mm-hmm. Don't confuse knowledge for belief.
Right.
And I think Kant did the same thing, but especially in the context of science, because scientists tend to want to speak as scientists about stuff beyond necessarily. This was his commentary. So he was basically saying, like, know when you're going beyond your own field. Know mm-hmm. when you're going beyond your expertise. Know when you're going beyond your reasonable foundations, and distinguish between what's knowledge and what's vague and belief. Because the problem is people often put too much weight in stuff that's just a belief that they treat like knowledge,
right.
or don't acknowledge that it's not.
Well, first of all, I will never argue belief with anyone. I will always lose. You can't right. argue belief, because belief isn't based in anything factual. It can't be, because if it is, it's no longer belief. And that's what Greg Braden in one of his books talked about on our program in terms of the spontaneous healing of belief. That was the title of his book. And he said that we are transitioning mm-hmm. as a species from a position of belief to a position of knowing.
Interesting.
Yes. Well, I was waiting for a moment when we might speak a bit about Carl Jung, who's very mm-hmm. important to Pacifica and played an important part in this book on evolving God images. And mm-hmm. in fact, the very title is really, in effect, kind of borrowed from Jung. Because like what you've said, Jung argued clearly that we can't know anything about God. And actually, we'll just mention the philosopher Kant. Mm-hmm. Jung's philosophy was actually based upon the theory of knowledge that Kant propagated, which basically made a distinction between a thing in itself, which is actually ultimately unknowable, mm-hmm. whatever mm-hmm. thing that may be, including God, and our image or representation, our fantasy of what that thing is.
Right.
So basically, we're trading in God images, mm-hmm. What we think God is like.
Yeah.
And those images can change. And actually, I would add, they must change mm-hmm. if you're to have a sustainable, fulfilling life as an individual, and on a collective level, if we are to actually have a kind of a global society or global world in which we can live, coexist with one another peacefully.
I had a conversation like that with my sister once around holidays, and I told her, I said that my beliefs of today are not my beliefs of yesterday, or mm-hmm. and they're not my beliefs of tomorrow, because I'm constantly experiencing, growing, and changing.
Which means that they don't have to be, instead of having treating them as absolute knowledge,
yeah.
It's always a working process.
There's a certain agnosticism, isn't there?
There is. Yeah.
So this is a good opportunity for me to transition us to the second half of the conversation, because I think that what we're starting to get into, we're starting to talk a little bit about theory of knowledge. And we started off really kind of anchored around foundationalist theories of knowledge. I had a great opportunity to take an epistemology course with Dr. Kahn at University of the South in Suwanee, Tennessee. And we really talked about the difference between coherentism and foundationalism as theories of knowledge. And those sound like big words, but they're very simple ideas. One is that you're building your knowledge based on solid foundations, like Descartes was saying, and Cartesian foundationalism is kind of like the purest form of foundationalism. But the other is coherentism, and it's the idea that you're kind of whatever you what you believe is what makes the most sense of everything else, you know? So it's like this.
That's right.
And so what happens is if you shift from a foundationalist point of view to maybe a coherentist point of view, instead of trying to find a foundation that I can build all my thoughts on, instead you try and learn everything you possibly can, because you know you can only evaluate what you believe based on its consistency with what is in all that's out there. Yeah.
Well, beautiful segue actually into another aspect of the book, which was the seminar was the point of departure was to reflect on the implications of the death of the God, of death of God in the mm-hmm. West, or the death, to be more specific, the death of a traditional God image that was no longer working for many people in an increasingly secular society. And Mark C. Taylor, one of the leading edge scholars of religion that mm-hmm. we have today, we read his book called After God. And in this book, he basically is making the case for systems of belief, religious or not, that are not predicated upon absolutes. And in fact, mm-hmm. the final culminating chapters are an ethics without absolutes, mm-hmm. Which incidentally is exactly what the Dalai Lama is calling for. Mm-hmm. His most recent book is actually called Beyond Religion. And in that book and in the other book I referred to earlier on Towards the Kinship of Faiths, he notes that we have to have a secular ethics. Why? Mm-hmm. Because no one system of ethics based in one particular religious worldview is going to be embraced by people that are holding
a... Just not going to happen.
It's just not going to happen. So we kind of have to have a meta-ethics, and that takes us into the realm of compassion and the golden rule, which is by no means a principle unique to
Christianity. But here's a twist.
Yes.
Because that is a foundation. That is a singular foundation. But I think this is important because it's not exactly a foundation like God exists. It is, by definition, the foundation is pluralistic, is open, is inclusive, is totality, you know, because compassion is something that only makes sense in relationship with. So it's a pretty twist of a foundation.
And I twist it a little further. Instead of quoting it directly, which I can do, I've sort of rewritten it. Do unto others as if you were the others. So would you do that to yourself?
Precisely.
And then you actually take everybody else out of the equation. It's just you and you.
That's right. Yeah. Makes it very immediate.
Now, in terms of this business of knowledge that we're talking about, okay, I could ask, well, what is knowledge? But here's the catch that I see, and I want a further explanation on this. 500 years ago, the knowledge that the church handed down was that we were at the center of the universe.
Authoritative
knowledge. We were the pearl in God's eye.
Right.
And it has since been disproven that we are not. Let me rephrase that. That the evidence that has been presented from a cosmological perspective, the macro view, is that as far as we know, this planet is not the center of the cosmos.
Clearly.
I mean,
it's definitely not the center of our solar system.
And it's not the center. Yeah, we're on one of those spirals out near the edge, if I'm not mistaken.
Third, yeah.
Yeah. And so if we were going to be the center, then we would be in the middle. But if you've ever seen hurricanes, the middle of a hurricane is it's dormant. It's quiet.
It's empty, right.
And there's
the
no,
empty center.
There's no movement. There's no action. There's no activity. There's no challenge.
Okay, can I go cherry pick something? Because I referenced the hurricane, the swirl, in my own comprehensive exam for my senior essays in college, because I think that the swirl is very interesting in that it is clearly has a point and a foundation and a center. Yet that center is completely empty and nothing and not a thing. So it's like you can point to it, but you can't call it an inherently a thing. It has a point and a foundation, and but at the same time, it's codependent on everything else around it. And I think this is more like a foundation, like sunyata or something like
that. Yes, no thing, or nothing, or nothingness, or emptiness, to be a little bit more correct in terms of how the Buddhist term sunyata would be translated, is in fact the very doctrine of absolute interrelatedness. So, you know, I slipped the word absolute in, but what's absolute is the fact that everything is relative.
Right.
So back to Taylor, and here making a kind of marriage between a leading edge Western thinker and an exemplary Buddhist thinker like the Dalai Lama, what they share in common from two very different cultural heritages and two different thought systems, you know, that they're immersed in, is the idea that what we need as a basis for life is a conviction of relationalism. In fact, to put it in a phrase, you know, to be is to be related, or to be is to be connected. I would like to slip in a brief paraphrase from one of our Western sages that makes sense in this connection. And it's from, let me read the phrase, and then we'll just take a guess at who who this might have come from. So consider who would say such a thing. A human being is the part of the whole called by us universe, a part limited in time and space. He or she experiences herself or himself, thoughts and feelings, as something separated from the rest, a kind of optical delusion of consciousness. This delusion of being separate in that way is a kind of prison for us, restricting us to our personal desires and to affection for a few persons nearest to us. Our task must be to free ourselves from this prison by widening our circle of compassion to embrace all living creatures and the whole of nature in its beauty. Who would say something like that? What's your guess? Would each of you take a guess?
I couldn't even hazard a guess.
I've got, you know, two are popping in my head, and I think they're both wrong. But I mean, it sounds like something I could see James Hillman calling for hard. But not actually, you know, it sounds like more to me, and I don't think this is right either. But Richard Tarnas makes some comments like this about, you know, when he goes into philosophy and some of the egoistic tendencies in Western philosophy and the emerging network-like paradigm. But that was not right. Who
well,
was
my
it?
My guess would have been the Buddha.
The Buddha.
And maybe Thich Nhat Hanh.
Uh-huh, yeah.
And I actually think that James Hillman and Richard Tarnas, they would resonate with this. They mm-hmm. would agree with it. But it actually was Albert Einstein.
Really?
Wow.
And wow. I dropped in, and of course, he's famous in the scientific sense for this theory of relativity.
Uh-huh.
And I'm not invoking this as a scientific theory,
right.
but I'm invoking it as a existential, mm-hmm. you know, a cultural principle
mm-hmm.
that relationalism or is another way to describe what human relativity means in terms mm-hmm. of our interaction as individuals and cultures.
Right. Which I think is some people have, you know, shame on them, have misinterpreted Einstein's theory towards absolute relativism and absolute cultural relativism and which leads towards a nihilism and et cetera, which I think that's really a misguided interpretation. I think some scientists have spoken out being critical of people that have done that with his theories. Whereas this, the relationalism that he's, you know, talking about here is to really, it's not purposeless. It's the value of life is this, is the interaction, is relation, not to take away value because everything's just related.
And we're talking not only individuals and cultures and religious mm-hmm. traditions, we're also talking about fields of knowledge or hmm. sciences.
Mm-hmm.
Because one of the things that distinguishes the modern worldview from the traditional worldview that preceded it was a differentiation of mm-hmm. scientific inquiry from religion,
right.
from art. You know, prior to that, during the Inquisition that was referred to earlier, you know, with physicists, if you mm-hmm. made a proclamation that the Earth wasn't at the center of the, mm-hmm. You might lose your life, or
right.
you might be
oh,
imprisoned.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Right.
But once that differentiation was achieved, it became safe, and each of these domains could operate, you know, by its own rules and relative independence from one another. And mm-hmm. that was a great breakthrough.
Right. Right.
But that differentiation also became a kind
schism.
Of dissociation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And actually, with respect to the search for foundations, it's as though each particular science, physics, biology, mm-hmm. chemistry, but also, you know, some of the social mm-hmm. sciences as well, tries to uniquely establish its own, you know,
paradigm of
paradigm
itself,
or,
yeah.
or foundations, when in fact that gives us a very fragmented,
absolutely,
you know, picture of what the world is. So part of what Taylor and many others are calling for is what I would describe as a more integral or connected
mm-hmm.
way
mm-hmm.
of holding these views together, recognizing that all of them are partial,
mm-hmm.
but not the complete story.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the way we calibrate or interweave these different visions that actually provide a more coherent, to mm-hmm. go back to your term,
mm-hmm.
sense of what, you know, our life is about and what kind of cosmos we inhabit. And what's possible for us as human beings in our individual lives and also in our shared lives.
A very modern phrase is we're all connected. And we're
yes.
we're seeing programs that depict this. There was one called Touched, this little boy who
yeah.
doesn't speak, yet he writes numbers all the time. And his
huh.
father, who used to be in 48 Hours, I forget the name of the show. It was 48 Hours by the actor. Anyway, and so they would be taken on this journey through this episode. And what you would see would be three or four different stories, totally
mm-hmm.
independent of one another.
But they would...
They would intersect at
uh-huh.
certain points, and that if they hadn't, that then the next step would not have happened. So you start
right.
to see the interconnectedness, the chain
There's
of events.
There's an Academy Award-winning film. What was it? Crash did that.
I have yet to see that. I don't want to
yes.
see it. But there are more movies mm-hmm. like that are
That's
coming
right.
out. And that some will even say, well, we call it the butterfly effect. Well, yes, but not
right.
quite. It's not
no.
quite
right.
that simplistic in that respect. It is more that you must be about your life's purpose,
mm-hmm.
which is a whole nother discussion. And Will and I have talked about this in previous programs where we even brought up the subject of the Borg from Star Trek Next
right,
Generation.
Yeah. Glenn came in and talked with that.
Oh,
yeah,
great,
yeah.
great.
And how I said that I don't know if Roddenberry meant it in this context, mm-hmm. but what I have begun
mm-hmm.
to see is a very strong representation of the spiritual connectedness that we all share. We're all getting intuitive messages. Whether we follow the promptings or not, it's another story. And if we are, no two messages are the same. Your message isn't the same as mine. Your task isn't the same as mine. Your purpose isn't. And yet it all plays together in the big picture, which we can't see. Whereas, and with the Borg, it's the same thing. They have this collective consciousness, if you will, or they're receiving information from who knows. And that's the other
thing.
All of
themselves.
It could be all of themselves. Right. We did find out in one of the movies, I think it was, that it was this one female character who
but
was
we talked
aboard.
In the show that could yeah. maybe
the,
or maybe
the
not
movie
have been
her?
Original. Yeah.
Sure.
No,
the,
oh, right, oh, right. Okay. No, the movie, the First Contact.
First Contact,
I,
right.
I see.
Mm-hmm. And so... So I sat here and I'm thinking, okay, no, if we were all doing that, if we were all listening and we were all, shall we say, following the promptings, okay? Because it's all about free will. But if you're following the promptings, in a manner of speaking, you're consciously and willfully giving up your free will
right.
to that intuitive message and guidance, ergo... It's no longer you. There's a great book called The Impersonal Life.
But what a paradox, right? We talked about that with Zaman, because Islam is all about that submission.
And his definition of Allah was what you talked about earlier. Just fascinating stuff. Another thing that we are interconnected with is segments. We need to take a quick break. I'm Richard Dugan. This is Tell Me Your Story. This is Mythosophia, New Paradigms for a New World, and we are exploring the depths of myth and wisdom. Stay tuned. Welcome back to Tell Me Your Story, New Paradigms for a New World. This is Mythosophia, part 12 of 12, and we're talking with Patrick Mahaffey, and we're talking some extraordinary stuff here. And we left off in our last segment, of course, as I was kind of pontificating, about the concept even in terms of the concept of God and your evolution of God images and so forth as they've progressed. To the point where I think the majority of people on the planet today, I may be wrong, or maybe in the United States, I know that fewer people consider themselves of a specific religion or philosophy, but they consider themselves spiritual, and they do believe in at least a higher power or a force, and that type of thing, that we're all trying to tap into.
You commented on this in your book on the modern use of spirituality. What's your take?
Traditionally, the term would have referred to the contemplative dimension of a religious tradition, meaning specifically the monastics, the monks and nuns that are taking up the quote-unquote religious life in cloistered environments. But gradually, that kind of more contemplative life has become first available to lay people, but I think much more recently in the last 10-15 years, and I think this is a trend that I predict will accelerate, it's unhinged altogether from direct affiliation to religious traditions.
Yeah.
So if we're going to try to come up with this sort of most clear, simple definition of what is spirituality about, it has to do with direct experience. And this takes us actually back to Jung and some comments from the previous segment, because particularly when we're talking about the notion of belief, you know, Jung late in his life was interviewed by the BBC, and he got a question that he didn't anticipate when he was sitting being interviewed as I am, and he was asked essentially, "Do you believe in God?" And he was startled, actually, just as you were with the gesture there, and paused for a moment, and he said, "I don't have to believe I know." Now, that's a beautifully cryptic statement, because I myself can't claim to unpack and reveal exactly what he meant by that. And I did come across some material later through scholarship that gives a bit more of a clue about, you know, what he may have had in mind when he said that. But what we can be sure of is this, and this was fundamental to his psychology, and he wrote voluminously on religion, actually used the word God over 6,000 times in his collective works, was that for spirituality to be viable, it has to be something that you directly experience. If it's just a set of beliefs, it's not alive.
And
basically, you know, he came from a tradition of pastors. His father was a pastor. And basically what sort of impelled him in large measure on his own quest was seeing that his father, basically, his faith was empty. His father was...
And he struggled when he was dying with his faith, right? Like,
yeah. And he basically saw, he literally said something like, I saw my father cracking up, you know, before my eyes.
Yeah.
And he realized
that
he had to go on his own quest. And what's interesting here, when I say spirituality can be disengaged from religion, that's true, and I think that's oftentimes appropriate and desirable. But I want to qualify that. It doesn't mean that it should be non-cognizant of the text and the writings and experiences, the great wealth of material, you know, that's available to us. So in this case, you know, we reflect upon, you know, what was the experience of a Luther? What was the experience of a Teresa of Avila? What was the experience of, Thomas Merton? And not because we're trying to practice like they did or claim an affiliation that they had, but to make sense in a coherent way of what works for us.
But at the same time that we're trying to make sense of it through their experiences, we will have experiences that will be judged by others. This was a sad thing that used to happen quite often back in my Christian radio days. Somebody would have an experience that you couldn't find justification for in the Bible, ergo, the experience was nullified.
You know what? We had Jeff on, and he was really Jeff Kripal was great on this point because one of his things is that if we can't look at alien abduction stories today and relate them to how popular sci-fi aliens and abductions are, if we can't look at those in relationship, then how can we? Then it's likely he compares that to the way that we kind of try and dismiss the real spiritual and transcendent experiences in the Bible, and we take them off the table because they're hard to explain. But he's looking at, like, today, modern spiritual experiences show us how ridiculous it is to take that off the table.
I would even place my example of earlier as potentially a spiritual experience of doing something with no fear, which is we're all trying to find that place where we can live our lives without fear, because fear just consumes us. It destroys us physically and biologically and so forth.
And so this is one of the big questions I want to ask you, Patrick, is fear often, some people might say, comes from a self-referential point of view, an egoistic point of view. And both Jung and the yogic tradition, which you engage in your article in Spring, both of them react to the ego as a limiting factor, is something that kind of keeps us from knowing more or experiencing more. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, I'd be happy to. And I want to, you know, say that with all due respect to people who would critique the ego as being the great obstacle to spiritual life or personal fulfillment, I think that word can be literalized or concretized in a way that isn't particularly helpful. I mean, basically, at the most functional level, the ego is simply a capacity that we have within our psychophysical organism to make distinctions, to know where I end and where you begin, and what and that would make me not step out in the street in front of a car, you know, that's coming by. So ego at that level is not a problem.
Right.
You know, the ego that is a problem, you know, would be maybe better rendered as self-centeredness or egocentricity.
Okay.
You know.
Okay.
So it's the egocentric attitude is what's a problem, and what is the problem precisely? Well, the problem, I would render it something like this: And I think this really holds true for both, say, Jungian psychology, but also Hindu yoga traditions. Mm-hmm. The ego is a limited perspective. It's one-sided.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it is dissociated or disconnected from the larger psychic matrix of which it is a part. So, and the egocentric attitude is characteristic of a waking, rational consciousness. And what softens its rigidity or its limited perspective are unusual experiences in waking life or experiences that, like dreams. Or if you want to be systematic and directly intentional about it, if you engage in prayer or forms of meditation, you are, in effect, embarking upon a journey from one smaller part of your totality to the larger field that is the very basis or matrix from which you live. And what contemplative traditions, East and West, and certainly the one that I've practiced the most, the Hindu traditions, argues, is that beneath the levels of conditioning that have to do with age and gender and occupation and able-bodiedness or lack thereof, size, etc., is a observing, witnessing part of our being that just is. And in order to access it, you have to be willing to sit still for a while and just watch the thoughts and emotions that arise and float by. And gradually you begin to touch that space within yourself that is what Jung sometimes called the non-ego. In fact, he even said in some of his writings, the non-ego is another word that I use for God, or what he more typically would describe as the capital S self. So what Jung also said, and I think it's consistent for yoga traditions, is that during the first half of life, and let's just roughly define this as the first 3.5 decades, first 35 years or so, beginning with infancy, of course, the new being, you know, has to emerge from the mother and acquire an identity. So the first phases of life, childhood, adolescence, young adulthood, is what some people have called the identity project. And it's a worthy project, and it should not be abandoned by any means, or your life is compromised. And
you guys are supposed to be past it. just kidding. I'll keep building.
But the problem, you know, with the so-called midlife crisis, and I think we now have come to appreciate there's probably more than one of those, but the classic one that occurs roughly between 38 and 41, is that that identity project begins to have diminishing returns. And it has diminishing returns because that emergent ego, that emergent identity, has basically severed the connection from the matrix out of which it emerged. So now the task of the second half of life is to reestablish a connection, not an identity, or at least from Jung's point of view, but a connection to that source that you had lost, become disconnected to. And he describes that as the ego-self relation or the ego-self access. And what is required is that you vigilantly engage in a kind of dialogue with that larger totality of what you are. And so here, you see, I haven't negated the ego. You know, I haven't given it a bad name, but I'm saying it has to acknowledge that there's something larger, and it has to effectively, in lived experience, establish a connection to what that is. And where the differences come in with respect to, say, Western Jungian psychology and an Eastern contemplative tradition like Hindu yoga, is that Jung was mostly interested in having a dialogue with the contents, the symbols, the images, the feelings that arise from the unconscious, and to be informed by what those contents may be, you know, showing you or trying to get you to see. And his, you know, his mode of meditation was actually what was called active imagination, and that's just another way of saying entering into a relationship and a dialogue with those contents.
Right.
Now, with the yoga contemplative traditions, the focus is that you want to not particularly engage the contents, but just watch them float by so that you can touch into what is beneath the contents, the background out of which the contents show up in the foreground. And Jung actually said very clearly in a seminar on Kundalini Yoga that he gave in 1932 that the East is fascinated, the West is fascinated with the foreground of consciousness, what's arising in consciousness, whereas the East has always been fascinated with the background.
You know, they've done studies to prove that. Actually, Eastern, like Chinese children, will recognize more of the background in a show, in a TV show, whereas American children focus very much on the main character.
Yeah. So now, speaking a little bit more personally in terms of where I'm going with my own work and my own life, is I think it's perfectly valid to pursue, you know, the active engagement with the contents that you can access in your unconscious. That's a valid path. And Jung called that individuation.
Right.
And we might also call that growing up, because it means the increasingly, an increased capacity to integrate the fragments or parts or aspects of your life into some kind of integrated whole. Valid project, to be sure.
Absolutely.
And one I'm engaged in.
Yeah.
But the project of trying to encounter some birthless, deathless, timeless ground of being out of which your thoughts and feelings and sensations, you know, arise, has been, could be, is typically, you know, called a process of awakening that culminates in enlightenment. So we could call that waking up.
Growing up and waking up.
Yeah. And that also is a valid pursuit. And some people have pursued that with very little attention or giving very little importance to the other process. But I think that in the world we live in, we're really called to do both of these things. You know, so here's another instance of let's relate these things.
Okay.
You know, why make them separate? Why privilege one over the other? And in fact, it may actually be a huge mistake to privilege one over the other, particularly in a Western context. Both you and I, you know, have engaged in these yoga practices. First book that turned me onto it was also Yogananda's autobiography.
Which there is now a movie out.
I'm eager to see it on
Christmas Eve.
Oh, wow.
It's when it arrives in Santa Barbara.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, that's when it's going to debut here.
Oh, I can hardly wait.
You mean a few days ago?
Yes.
But okay, if I can just quickly finish the point, though. But the issue is let's say you pursue the waking up project, you know, in a Western context. Well, this is where shadow issues, so to speak, can arise, because it may mean that you're becoming enamored with that project means that you don't pay attention to your career, you don't pay attention to your spouse or your children. You don't.
It's all about leaving, in a way.
It could well be about leaving. That's
like
right.
It could 60s, be an escapist. I'm going off to find myself.
Transcendence. It's,
Or you actually manage to experience something rather sublime, and it turns out that other parts of you are far from grown up. You know, and this could be, you know, sexual parts of you, financial parts of you, and we know we have no lack of examples of how this has gone awry, not only with practitioners but their teachers. So I think both of these are really need to be connected in one way or another.
Yeah.
Would you say that it's a reconnecting, a reawakening? I say that in the context of childhood. Specifically, for example, in the Bible, the quotes are, I'm not going to say, and Jesus said, the quotes are in the Bible, that unless you come to me as little children, and we think about the purest aspect of a child, a slate that is clean, a mind that is fertile with imagination, and excitement and all of these things, and is probably, maybe unconsciously, following the promptings of that higher self, that intuition. They don't even question it. They go.
Yeah.
Yes.
And then as we are growing up and we are then, quote unquote, taught, we disconnect.
I think we're taught that ego to some extent, too.
And we're taught a greater ego.
Yeah.
And so then as we get into the second half, my great-grandmother lived to be 100, so and she was 90 when I made the statement, I'm going to outlive my great-grandmother. And when she reached 80, 98, 99, I said, she's making it really hard.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm in the second half of my life. My midlife crisis was probably about 48, 49. But as you've asserted, we're in that phase where now we're wanting to connect, we're wanting to listen, we're wanting to follow, we're wanting to do all of these things that put us back where we were as children.
Yes, but you raise a very interesting point. I want to make a couple of distinctions about it.
Okay.
Because on the one hand, I think I would render that statement of Jesus that you, I think, paraphrased quite well. I would read that as, yes, we need to become more trusting, as we were discussing earlier, trust being a word for faith, being able to jump, being realize that something will, as structures dissolve, new ones will emerge. To use your example, new jobs, new sources of livelihood, new way to configure your life, new place to live. So that kind of trust and surrender and openness, yes. But are we called to re-embrace the innocence of the actual child? I don't think so.
And there may be a
desire to do that, but I don't think it's mature. I don't think it's really where we actually want to go. In fact, Paul Ricoeur, a very important 20th century philosopher, coined a phrase, second naivete. And I like that very much because basically we do naturally and appropriately grow out of the naivete and the innocence of the child. That may well include going through a period of cultivating the rational mind and critical intelligence, which is a valuable thing, not something to be denigrated and discarded. The question is there a kind of trust and openness on the other side of the development of one's rationality and critical intelligence. Mm. And he's asserting, and I'm asserting, and others, I believe, assert as well, that there is. And that's what we want. So it isn't totally a return to some more innocent way of being in the world. It's a post-rational, post-critical consciousness phase of our existence.
It reminds me a little bit of the way that the Oedipus complex works, where, you know, the idea is that, you know, maybe you're attracted to a woman somewhat like your mother. That may be natural. But if you actually want to go backwards to your actual mother, that's where it is. That's where it's regression as opposed to.
That's right.
Right.
Good.
And actually, as we talk about these processes, you know, we have with you and your experience in the mythological studies program, we can go a little bit different direction than just a religious studies program. We focus on processes and stories and sequences. And I was wondering if you could comment on what looking at things in processes and sequences might add to this conversation and search for faith and belief.
Yeah, I'm not sure that processes and sequences are absent, you know, from religious studies.
Of course,
typically
of course.
Configured, especially if we're looking at the way things change over time in terms of historical traditions and the way texts are interpreted. I think the difference with mythological studies, particularly as it's uniquely configured at Pacifica Graduate Institute, is this depth psychological substrate that I referred to earlier. And I think it's important that I just, for your listeners, make it really clear what we mean by depth.
Please do.
Depth psychological. Yeah. The word depth simply refers to those aspects of our consciousness that are beneath the threshold of our conscious waking experience, which is a vast reservoir, you know, of symbols, images, and metaphors that can deepen our understanding of ourselves and our world if we are able to access, you know, that material. So in terms of processes and sequences, what I have described as dream interpretation, active imagination or dialoguing with the contents of the unconsciousness, or in more yoga contemplative terms, watching, noticing, yes, I have feelings, but I am not my feelings. I have thoughts, but I am not my thoughts. I have sensations, but I am not my sensations. You know, what is below, you know, any of these identifications? What knows that you are having those thoughts, feelings, and actions? It's the attention to those aspects below conscious awareness that I think mythological studies gives more attention to. And the narratives and stories about a descent into the other world, you know, are beautiful exemplifications. because what is the underworld other than entering into this domain called the unconscious, this mysterious realm that's beyond the borders of our familiarity and comfort zone that we need to discover, explore, and ultimately reap a harvest from from that process. And not just for our own good, but for the relationships that we have with others. So bringing back the boon, you know, is the culmination, you know, of Joseph Campbell's rendering of the hero's journey.
Right.
So I think it's, I think that's what mythological studies with a particular emphasis, you know, with depth psychology gives us an opportunity to explore that is neglected in traditional religious studies programs.
Thank you for that answer.
This hour has gone by so fast. and now I know why I had the goosebumps, because this was awesome to wrap up our 12-part series. But I'm not finished with you yet, Patrick. I want to ask you three follow-up questions, although there were a bunch of other questions that are just milling around inside my head that I wanted to ask you about. And I'm actually going to ask you a few of them just the same. I want to know from your perspective, because I know where you're coming from now, but where were you as you were growing up spiritually? In terms of your and how has that influenced you in terms of your work and your study and mythology and comparative religions and so forth?
It's a beautiful question. It could be a long story, so I have to keep it concise. I grew up as a Lutheran. My father was an Irish Catholic, very alienated from his tradition. My mother was a Lutheran. I think my father was actually an agnostic, but it was confirmed in the Lutheran Church. It was a reasonably liberal congregation. When I went to the university, the first thing I decided in the first quarter was I wanted to suspend all beliefs whatsoever.
Oh, good for you.
And just expose myself to whatever was impressive. And I began to take psychology classes, ended up majoring in religious studies with a minor in philosophy. And during my junior year, I was sitting in a class and heard that overheard somebody speaking about an English professor that had a meditation group at his home. I was fascinated. I showed up at his door. He welcomed me in. We went downstairs. It was my first meditation experience. We had tea afterwards upstairs and discovered that he was connected to an Indian yogi that visited the United States. No one that had a famous name, so I won't, you know, mention it. But truly a very revered figure in India who came annually. And during the next time that he came, I received an initiation from him. And I was about 22 years old, you know, at that time. So since that time, I've continued to practice in related lineages. And once coming to Pacifica a little over 20 years ago, I had my first opportunity to take sabbaticals. And the first two sabbaticals, each 3 months long, I traveled to India and spent time in many different locations, especially in ashrams and prolonged retreats. Around that time, I should add, I also underwent my first experience of Jungian analysis for 3.5 years, and that has something to do with my conviction of why these two things need to be, you know, put together. And again, keeping this story somewhat short, you know, analysis is a useful thing, but most of us, Woody Allen jokes aside, you know, don't want to be in perpetual analysis. So the thing that is sort of the most recent development in my repertoire of practices is engaging in what has been traditionally called self-inquiry. And it can, but you can, in a modern context, broaden that in a few different ways, because the deep question, you know, from the tradition itself would be to ask, as Ramana Maharshi asked, you know, who am I?
Yeah.
You know, much like a koan.
Yeah.
And that's the way to, that goes deepest. Yeah. But as practical people with families and careers living in an increasingly complex society, you also have to enter into a kind of inquiry about how did you feel about what happened at work today, that conflict that you had, that anger you felt. How do you feel about the disconnect you might be feeling from your spouse right now? How do you feel about, you know, what you're eating or overeating or overdrinking? And I think, you know, a vigilant attention to those kinds of questions, you know, are a way to keep yourself grounded, you know, on the earth, and where your spirituality is not just an otherworldly quest for peak experiences, but to maybe do to accomplish the greatest miracle of all, which Thich Nhat Hanh said is to walk on the earth. mm-hmm. or maybe to walk on the earth consciously and with gratitude mm-hmm. for the way it supports your steps along life's journey.
Because of our conversation today, I am wanting to ask you, and you don't necessarily have to answer this question, but we can ponder it for another time. What is it that, from your perspective, and again, trying to keep it somewhat focused when it comes to spirituality, this life and the hereafter, what is it that you believe and know, or that you don't believe and don't know about some of those basics? Do you believe or not believe that there is a God? Do you know or not know that there is a God, that there's a heaven or hell, that there is a hereafter, that we will be judged, that we are just here for, just here to experience as opposed to here to serve and, from the Catholic tradition, there's a little, I think, in the Lutheran too, to suffer. can you expound a little bit on that?
Yes, I think I can. You know, William James wrote a classic book around 1900 called The Varieties of Religious Experience. And one of the terms, now there might be a better term that we could coin, but I think he did us a great service by saying, he introduced a phrase he called over-beliefs. And we could find another term for that. But basically what he meant by it was precisely what you're asking me about. Is it possible to have convictions about these very ultimate matters without holding them with certainty, with acknowledging that you can't actually prove it or know.
Right.
And, you know, I've lived long enough that I am allowing myself to have, you know, over-beliefs. Mm-hmm. And I do think that there is a divinity. And I think it's a formless, nameless singularity. But I would also add that I think it has many faces and many personalities, and that those are actually rich to engage with. So that's a bit abstract, but I'm actually saying that. In fact, let me put it a different way. I think it is possible, and indeed I personally seek, to have what you might call a first, second, and third person experience of God. What would that mean in brief? It's very simple. A third person experience of God is to experience nature as being somehow divine. All right? I think many of us experience that, mm-hmm. including atheists, the so-called atheists. A second-person experience of God is the tricky one, I think, for a lot of highly educated people, because that would be that in some manner you perceive the God, you perceive the divine as being in some manner personal that you can in some way communicate with. And that's the leading edge, actually, of where I'm going, but I'm enjoying exploring that. A first-person experience of God is actually to experience the depth of your own being, you know, the silence, the stillness within yourself. Now, you could go for any one of those, or sadly, for none of those, but I'm a bit, you know, polymorphous perverse, and I want to go for all of them. and I also would say that I don't know that it ultimately makes a real difference or not, whether there is reincarnation and additional lives that we've lived before and will live again. But my working hypothesis actually is that we do. And part of that, there's a number of different reasons why I, you know, came to this kind of, you know, conclusion. And one of them, you know, was a fairly mystical experience of actually gazing at a person. And this was unplanned, unevoked, just happened, where I basically saw the person's face, you know, morphing, you know, before my eyes. I felt kind of caught up in a vortex where I think the same thing was happening simultaneously. So it had the quality of feeling like I've known this person, you know, for many, many, many times.
Yeah.
More equally or more significant for me is after traveling to India and pushing my own comfort zone, I cannot explain rationally to you why I love India, why I love Indian people, why I love Indian music, why I love Indian spirituality, why I love all things Indian. They feel like my tribe, and I don't have a good rational explanation for
that. I was almost surprised you came in American clothes.
So maybe I should would that suffice?
It's excellent, excellent. I will add an addendum, and that is that I had the privilege, and I say this quite honestly, of interviewing an atheist on this program. And they, at least from my experiences of this gentleman, atheists are spiritual.
Yes.
They don't buy into a lot of the, I think maybe the way he phrased it, a lot of the
authorities
nonsense.
Authorities or something,
you know, the doctrine and dogma.
I agree.
Just don't buy into it.
I agree completely.
Yeah,
in fact, you know, there's several people referred to as the new atheist, and the three people that are quickly named are Christopher Hitchens, Richard Dawkins, who wrote a book called The God Delusion, and Sam Harris. And Sam Harris's most recent book,
like
literally off the press, is called Waking Up, A Spirituality for Atheists.
Yeah.
And I think he's represents a growing edge, and that's why in my own book I included a whole section. One-fourth of the essays are on secular and atheist spirituality.
Well, my first experience of atheism was Madeline Murray O'Hare, who I found out about in the 80s. Because I was working for that religious radio station, and this letter came in telling us that the atheists were petitioning the FCC, and and turns out this letter's been circulating for decades since she's been trying to fight to do this. But this, she's not doing it, and hasn't been for 30 years. But it's just a letter that continually circulates. And God rest her soul. She is the only one that I was aware of. And I thought, my gosh, are all atheists so angry? That was the sad thing I found about her specifically.
Right.
But this gentleman that I spoke with, and he wasn't actually trying to represent atheists, but atheism, if you will, and that philosophy, I came away from that interview thinking, this is a spiritual guy. fascinating.
Yeah. Well, I just have to quickly add a footnote to that. Yeah. Technically speaking, Buddhists are atheists. In fact, I was, took great pleasure in listening to the Dalai Lama, say with a chuckle, "We Buddhists, we atheists," because they have a non-theistic conception of what divinity is.
Yeah.
Which is to say, they have no second person concept. If you want to really of.
My final three questions for you.
Oh, geez.
Who is Patrick Mahaffey?
Who is Patrick Mahaffey? I'm a person who loves life, who loves knowledge, who loves teaching, who loves learning, and is on a quest for both psychological wholeness and spiritual awakening.
What is it that you hope to or want to achieve through the work that you're doing now?
At a personal level, greater integration. At an intimate level, greater sense of communion with my life partner that I love, and at a social or collective level, to play some part in creating greater peace and harmony in the world.
And who inspires you?
A huge list of people, but just to name a few, the Dalai Lama, Thich Nhat Hanh, Thomas Merton, Martin Luther King Jr., Albert Einstein, Carl Jung, William James, and many of my colleagues and even my students as well.
I want to thank you so much for joining us here on the program and sharing your thoughts and insights. This series has just been incredible. I'm not sure how many of the programs you've had an opportunity to listen to. But for Will and I, it has just been an extraordinary journey these past 12 months. And to wrap up this year with you and the conversations about God and spirituality and what we know versus what we believe, I thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you, Will.
Will, I have a couple of questions for you as we wrap up this series.
Oh, geez.
All right. The first one is, how's your dissertation coming?
It's coming. It's going to happen. It's going to finish. Wasn't as sure about it when we started, but it's getting there. I think I'm going to have a draft done over Christmas.
Very good.
Before I get back from Christmas.
Very good. Now, the other question is more, there is the possibility that this series will continue into 2015. I'm going to tell our listeners, you're just going to have to stay tuned.
Mm-hmm.
Join us on Sundays at 7 a.m. and p.m. or go to the website, either mythosophia.com or richarddugan.com. And we'll let you know if we're going to continue this series into 2015. We're kind of in negotiations in that regard. But I got to tell you, this has been one hell of an education.
Yeah, it's been a really, thank you, Richard, for the opportunity to do this. It's been more than a pleasure.
And to think this all started over the Holy Grail.
Uh-huh.
You know what? I think we found it.
Oh, man, maybe. Many times.
Many times over. Well, again, Patrick Mahaffey, thank you so much. How can people get in touch with you?
At the website of Pacifica, www.pacifica.edu.
Pacifica.edu, great. And, Will, people can get through to you through mythosophia.com.
Yeah.
Your email's there, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm.
Great. People can get through to me either Richard at RichardDugan.com or TMYS, that's Tell Me Your Story, TMYS at RichardDugan.com. Until next year, can you believe it? I'm Richard Dugan. Love to Lal.